Our Savior. Heavenly Father, we thank you for many blessings, Lord. We thank you for just this washing over us this week, Lord, and gives us tonight a good day of this fellowship, Lord, and worship you. We ask the blessing on this all congregation's one, Lord, and everybody here. We're all facing different things in this life, Lord. We're facing different challenges and different things to face. And we ask your blessings upon us, Lord, as we transition our lives, Lord. Just in prayer. I should send this message last night because that's our thing about something that we're all going through. It could be a problem, it can be a challenge, it can be a blessing, it could be just, it's different. If you turn the Bibles to Exodus chapter 3, I think. See how. Chapter 2, I'm sorry. Well, this is a passage of scripture everybody has read or has heard about numerous times. Is the part where Moses freed Egypt. Everybody knows the part why Moses. You know, they found him in the little ark thing his mom put out there on the river. He was picked up by Pharaoh's daughter. He was raised as almost like a king, a prince. And he was still Egyptian and was exiled from Egypt. He ran away. But I want to start reading here. And let's see here. Let's start reading verse 16. Now the priest of Midian had 7 daughters, and they came drew water and filled the troughs of water to water their father's flock. And the shepherds came and drove them away. But Moses stood up and helped them and watered their flock. And when they come to Reuel, the father, he said, "How is it that ye are come so soon to today?" And they said, "Egyptians drew us out of the hand of the shepherds, and also drew water enough for us and watered the flock." And he said to his daughters, "And where is he? Why is it that ye have left us the man? Call him that he may eat bread." And Moses was content to dwell with the man, and he gave Moses Zipporah his daughter. I'll start with that verse right there. Moses was content. And if you read the story, you can book the whole thing, that in this time period here, Moses is running from Egyptians. And he was his place Midian, and he helped the daughter start of this man out. And he ended up taking and getting honor and wife. And he was content. He was content to love them. And it says, "And she bore him a son, and he called his name Gershom, for he said, I am a stranger in a strange land." And I'll start that right there. Is Moses got his place in his life, he was content. He was married now, he had flocked to tend to, things were going good for Moses. He was happy, he was content. But you know, contentment can mean some other things. We can say, you know, I'm content, I'm happy where I'm at. But it's not mean you really want to be. A lot of times we contend it as a word to say, I'm fine with things. But being fine with things does not mean exactly what we in my hearts want to be. You may be content with where you are right now. You may be content with your life. You may be content with how things go in your life. To the point of, I'm not mad, but I'm happy. I'm just content. Moses was content dwelling with the shepherd, with his family, his wife, his new family, being a shepherd. Being in a place where there's no problems, there's no issues, it's a day-to-day life going on. And I want to just put for a minute because we have all known that spot in our lives. We have all known contentment. We have all been to the place where we are happy where we are. And that's good. There's no opportunity. God says there's to be content. But sometimes things need to change. And I want to preach a message titled "A Different Step." Everyone in this room is right now is going through a change in their lives. Everybody is. So y'all just bought a new house. Y'all just moved out. New change. New life. We bought a phone a while back. We might have to spend a lot of money to buy a tractor that we have to have. That's a big step. Going down much in debt is a big step. Buying and getting a mortgage is a big step. Hey, Sam, y'all expected a daughter. A 2 sons. I ain't gonna lie, that is a big step. And Paul and Angie, y'all are now by yourselves in this house. Y'all are now, your daughters have moved out, and now, and this new step. And when I thought it's that, God should be arrested for the fact that we have to realize that it's not a bad step. They can read the blessings. Mostly it's going to be God. He was happy, but God didn't think God would deal with him yet. God said it's time for him to step. God changed our way. And I got 3 points here. He says, to make us strong and leave our comfort zone. We get comfortable too easy for whatever day they fly. I can have the times I told Aaron before when things get crazy. I look for day to day life where basically I know what's going, I know what time I'm going to work, I know what time to get home, I know what bills are, I know what I'm doing. It may be kind of drab and boring, but I know what I'm doing today. And sometimes, you know, we get more hate in day to life, but sometimes we get along with that day to life of just being calm. How many times have we been alive where we have had something big happen and we just long for that day to day life? We long to wake up in the morning and not expect anything that day besides going to work. That's a comfort zone. We know that we have something happen. We know, for instance, like we have a job. We don't have a job, but we don't necessarily like a job, but it's comfortable and that's where we like to be. Our house, our land, our car, anything we know, our relationships, everybody has a comfort zone, and we like human beings like to be in that comfort zone. And on average. Now, some people don't, but love the comfort zone. So, but why God changed the way because he wants us to improve. He wants us to go forward and find something new in his will. We cannot be in a comfort zone and improve our lives. If we are staying a day-to-day life, and we are completely fine and content with our lives, we are not improving. We are not going far without anything new. But God may say, you know, it's time for a change. Because you need to grow. You need to change your life. You need to learn something new. You know, I think, you know, a child riding a bike, a child learning how to do something small, you know, you have to say, you know what? You have to do it. Bump your car seat. I don't know how, I can't. Yes, you can. And after about how long does it take to buy a car seat when they do it? Like, oh, I can do it. And children have comfort zones as well. They know how it's depend on mommy, you know. That sound and that scares them, what do they do? Come run to mommy and daddy. You know, that phone, little scrape on the knee. I need a band-aid. Come run to mommy and daddy. But, you know, God wants us to do something different. God wants us to get to the point of growing to the point of now you're an adult. Now you can do something yourselves. And now he's not saying he'll leave us. He says God's been with us. Adult, even a teenage child, the mom and dad are right behind them somewhere, watching carefully. You know, when I was a teenager, I knew for a fact mom and dad had my back. You know, I was doing it myself. I was driving. I was going to work. I knew my brother behind me. I knew for if something happened I can handle, they're behind me. And that's what God is. God wants us to expand our horizon and do something different. Because doing something different will make us a better person, a stronger person. And not only that, the second point is, God wants us to give us a different path to touch others. If you're in a comfort zone and you're not stepping out doing anything, your ring of influence is very small. Because you're in contact with the people you're in contact with. It may be your wife, it may be your kids, that may be it. Or it may be your mom, dad, or your sisters. And God may say, you know what? Maybe your end goal is to be this great teacher. You may be this great preschool teacher. You may be this great nursing home operator. You know, you may be the great mom. But you know, God wants us to step out, you know? I remember when we got pregnant with Paul, the thoughts of it, you know, it was exciting, it was amazing to have our first child, and then when Ellie come along, it was a little different. When I did come along, it was a little more scary, because that's when you know you have, wait a second, my car was working more. But as you know, wait, there's only two of us told we only wouldn't catch all the pigs. Well, you know, but now, as it's running around, it's crazy, you know, and we like a hand of him. We can take it. Things that we do now, I think I know we do that when we had the stupid thing I took yet. Before we take and can really do our mission life, we have to be able to have it path, because that means what exactly God needs to take touch of us. You know, it may be a situation you can't do yourself. And you don't have to lie to somebody, you don't know. I mean, I'll put us who's worked in this room, who's worked a public job, I always work at home. Now the time comes when you can't live that by yourself. Or you can't, maybe that chair gets stuck. Or maybe that partner working at the cost of someone loving him and being your partner. Or maybe the very guy in some Walmart says, hey, how did Chuck go? You don't know what's going to start something. You don't know what's going to start by a different step in your life, touching someone else's lives. We're going to love to talk about things in the past, think about how little steps change big ways. You know, everybody knows an inch right here, an inch by an inch area, you go an inch off a line. 2 miles on the road, you'll be a mile off. God has us to touch something. It makes something small. And that may seem so little to you, but down the road, you may be influenced. You may be touching someone's lives you never dreamed of touching. Because God changed your step a little bit. That's that God can do. The third thing is to make us depend on Him. Now we all can vouch that as being completely true. When God changed your steps and gets out of comfort zone, and we are now, I've never been this way before, we depend on God a lot more. When you're not here first down tonight, you know, yes, you're going to pray to the Lord, ain't you? When you, that little girl first says, "Mommy, help me! You're busy and you're tired and I didn't tell you around the house." Please pray to the Lord. God makes us change our steps to make us depend on Him more, and it may be something. It's just a little bit of faith that takes, you know. He wants to be helpful. He wants to say, God, I need help. And sometimes that little different step, that little bit of pathway to get out of our comfort zone is what we need to really depend on Him fully. Because it's so easy to think, I'm depending on God all man. You know what to expect tomorrow. You know what to expect the next day. You know the money's coming in the bank. You know that money is, you might go stuck with. You know your house payments, but you got your power bills paid, and you got power. You don't have heat. But yet, again, God says, you know what? It's time for a different step. It's time for a different way. Because I'm going to make you different. I'll make you depend on me more, and I will use you in life. So that's the rest of it. We're in chapter 3. And at this point here, Moses was content, and then changed. Now Moses came to Jethro, his father-in-law, the priest of Midian, and he led the flock to the backside of the desert, and came to the mountain of God, even to Horeb. An angel of the Lord appeared to him in a flame of a fire in the midst of a bush. And he looked, and behold, the bush burned with fire, and the bush was not consumed. Now Moses, he kind of got himself, he done it then, if so to speak. He saw the bush, and he says, and Moses said, I will turn aside and see this great sight. Now, Moses, you have just completely changed your life, and you know it. Now, I think God wouldn't have done something different, but Moses said, I'll see what the bush is. And when Moses saw that went to the bush, it was his office changed for him. He was no longer going to be the subject in the flock of meetings. God had to fight him a different step now, a different way. And when the Lord saw he turned aside to see, God called him to the midst of the bush, Moses, and he said, here am I. And he said, draw not nigh hither, put off thy shoes from off thy feet, for the place wherein thou standest. Then he said, I am the God of thy father, and the God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, and the God of Jacob. And Moses hid his face, was afraid to look upon God. And then the Lord said, I will choose some of my people, which are in Egypt, and that have heard their cry by reason of the taskmasters. For I know the sorrows, and I am come down to deliver them out of the hand of the Egyptians, to bring them up out of the land into a good land, and a large into a land flowing with milk and honey. And so they place the Canaanites, and the Hittites, and the Amorites, and the Perizzites, and the Hivites, and the Jebusites. Now therefore, behold, the cry of the children of Israel is come to me, and I have also seen the oppression wherewith the Egyptians oppressed them. Come now therefore, and I will send thee to Pharaoh, and I must bring forth my people and the children of Israel out of Egypt. Now Moses was a priest who was a shepherd, and he happened to see a burning bush. What is that? He goes and looks at it. And now he's been charged by God to go down and rescue the children of Israel. What a shocker. What was Moses thinking? You know, we've all been in that place in our life where God has changed something, and we've all got our mouth open like, what? How did I get here? Why have things changed so much for me in a couple of seconds? But God said, it's time for me to step, Moses. He said, you have been, in your comfort zone, you have been a shepherd or sheep. He said, now, time's come for you to step. You now will go to Egypt and help our people out by. And that's what God does to us in our lives. God has prepared us for this point. If your life is changing right now, God has prepared you for this point. He has sowed his crop in you, and now it's time to do what he's called you to do. I'm saying, going to college is a big step. I've been there. That is a big deal. And it's already come from, isn't it? It's already come from, because it's now a step above anything you want. But God has a plan for all changing our lives. here's the next thing I think is so typical of our lives. Moses is the perfect Christian in my mind, if I read the book. Because he followed every law we follow of how he acts. The first thing he said, the most thing to God, who am I that I should go to Pharaoh and I should bring forth the children of Israel out of Egypt? If that's not a mirror image of each one of our lives, if we truthfully think we've been in this place where God said, okay, it's time to disappear. But who am I? I'm just a shepherd. How do I know what I'm doing? I can do that. But God has a plan. God knew for a fact what Moses was capable of. And knew the man of God Moses would become. Was Moses the perfect man? But Moses would not have understood if God had said, you know, this is a small task. This is the small thing I'm asking of you. Go to Pharaoh and tell him what the people go. If God said, but Moses, didn't you want to do it? I'm going to use you to call and play Egypt. Well, I'm using you to heal them, to order the times about to bring the plague of the first one Egypt. And you will be in the house and blow on the door, and I will pass away and kill anybody who's first born. And you know what happened to Moses then? You go drive people out into the desert, and they'll come to you. They'll bet it's not stone you because of their plane. And then I'll let you into the Red Sea, and the fish will come behind you, and they're going to be scared to death, and I'm going to pop the waters, you're going to walk across the dry ground. And then I will take and give you 10 commandments. And when you come back, the children of Israel are going to be sacrificed to a false god. And then I'm going to take and bring water and rocks, and then I'm going to complain and cry, and I'll bring manna down, and bring quail in, do this, would Moses have handled that? No. Moses would have short circuit. God has a plan for each one of us. And when he says it's time to change, we must admit truth in our hearts that God is right. If God gives us something to do, if God has brought a change on, and we are firmly knowing with our heart, we are in the best of our ability in the world. We can't be wrong. Our path will not be wrong. It can't be wrong. If we get out there to our minds, and it's thinking to our heart, and we realize that I'm in the will of God, I'm doing the best I can, and now something big comes in my life, it's okay. It's your brain bush experience. It's a time thing you don't understand. But you can't fail. No sense asking why. There's no sense asking why is this changing for me? Because you are perfect in the will of God, and God's going to direct you your paths. So when our different time comes, and by saying, "What's going to be?" I face something different, something new. And it may be a joyous experience. We may be excited about this coming. But even in the excitement, there's a little bit of doubt. There's some worry. There's some, well, what if I can't do this? What if I can't do that? What if I can't make payments on that tractor? What if I lose my job? What if the house starts falling in? What if the plumbing button's going out? What happens if I can't take care of those kids each day of the week? But God's preparing our heart for something big and massive. This is the first step, possibly, to a defining point in your life. God will say, you look back and say, God didn't plan it off, and I was scared. I mean, I think when Moses was, when he said all things in his life, did he look back and say, wow, why was I scared, God? Why was I scared of Pharaoh? I saw the back portions of God and we didn't take a minute. I'm scared. So, like Moses case when he was so, he was excuse after excuse after excuse. God faithfully answered every single excuse. If you read this, and you read this chapter here, God nails it every single time. This is why. When God changes our vision, when you have something new, and something this off what you've had in the past, we embrace that, accept that as something that God has ordained, and leave our worry and die at the door. We have to mess up that together because God has ordained it. He will make us a way to possibly do it. And one day, you look back at that thing you were so worried about, this, you know, or so, that little bit of pride, I don't know how to do that. It will see God's hand in the whole process. And then you'll think, that's a worry. So, when God gets you to a different step, don't know what Moses did, and don't take that question to God. If you're really in the will of God, and you know it, just walk it. Walk that path. Enjoy that path. Because you've done the right thing you had. I wish you wouldn't have worried, because it's been an amazing experience to know God brought us the past, you know? Turn to verse 18. And Moses went and returned to Jethro's father-in-law and said to him, "Let me go, pray thee, and turn to my brethren which are in Egypt, and see whether he can be alive." And Jethro said to Moses, "Go in peace." And the Lord said to Moses in Midian, "Go return to Egypt, for all the men are dead, and shall be alive." And Moses took his father and his son, and set them upon an ass, and he returned to the land of Egypt. And Moses took the rod of God in his hand. And the Lord said to him, "Moses, when thou goest to return to Egypt, see that thou do all these wonders before Pharaoh, which I have put in thine hand. For I will harden his heart, that he shall not let the people go. And thou shalt say unto Pharaoh, Thus saith the Lord, Israel is my son, even my firstborn. And I say to thee, Let my son go, that he may serve me. If thou refuse to let him go, behold, I will slay thy son, even thy firstborn." And it came to pass by the way of the inn that the Lord met him and sought him. And the poor took a sharp stone and cut off the foreskin of her son, and cast it at his feet, and said, "Surely a bloody husband art thou to me." So he let him go. Then she said, "Thou bloody husband art to me, because of the circumcision." Well, I mean, that thing, I didn't really understand when I said, "Well, Lord," I realized that Moses went by half-hearted. Moses didn't even circumcise his son yet when God called him. Which is asked Israel, Egypt, this to hear that from God. Moses was not believing. Moses was saying it because of something he had to do. He didn't really believe God could do it without miracles, because he would have done a small thing if he had really believed. And God stopped the kid. So, my thing is right here. We need to believe with our whole heart that the new direction God has set us in is His will. It is what He is waiting us to do. Like I said, if we are in the will of God and God gives something to do, we need to believe that, accept that God's faithfulness is through it. He will be there. And He will help us through that new thing, that issue, that new circumstance. Because you don't have to succeed if you do. I don't think if Moses were fulfilling this state of mind right here, I don't think he would have God would allow him to have to use the power he had for him. So the new direction God has given you, believe it, that God is going to be with you, there with you. Believe He can do what He said He can do. Embrace that new direction. Embrace that revelation of God's will in your life, that new circumstance. God's got a plan for us, and we need to accept that and believe that. We have seen the entire time of God's deliverance in our mind, in our lives. So at this point, if you got a new direction this morning, and we're going that direction, and you believe, and you kind of wonder about it, but if you're in the Word of God, you have to worry about it. A belief and trust in that direction is right. We don't go in 27. And the Lord said to Aaron, go to the wilderness and meet Moses. And he went and met him at the mount of God and kissed him. And Moses told Aaron all the words of the Lord which sent him and all the signs he had commanded him. And Moses and Aaron went gathered together the elders of children of Israel. And Aaron spake into the word in all the words the Lord had spoken to Moses and all the signs did all the signs of the people. And the people believed, and when they heard that the Lord had visited the children of Israel, that he had looked upon affliction. Then he bowed their heads and worshipped. At this point here, and God said, happened. Before Moses' first excuse he said was, how did they believe what I say? And God said, do signs for the people. So tell them, send who sent me. And guess what? The people listened. The people believed. So, Moses was, this should be plenty of faith for Moses right here. Because the first thing God said happened has come to pass. The people believed Moses' report from God. There comes a time when that new direction, you start walking that new direction, that new special thing God has changed your life. And there comes a point where it'll make sense. And you will get, I don't know, you'll understand and say, this is God's path for me. This is the way I'm going now. I see the change now happening. I see the first signs of God's hand in this path. When this time comes, it will come. If you are in His will and you are doing the best you can for His purpose, He will provide some kind of confirmation in your heart and mind. And this needs to be a point where basically all fear goes out the window. It's easier said than done. We all have been the part where God has changed something, and we're still a little bit worried, but yeah, wow, when God has slipped my mind, I'm on the right path now. I know I'm doing right. So we need to take and be ready for that and start looking for that. Look for that confirmation. Looking for that little help that will just get a little bit of faith building exercise, because that's the first thing. If God had was faithful in this and said, you know, the people, if you said the people will believe you, now Moses can say, you know what? Now I can go far. Now I can go before Pharaoh and fish the rest of that. Because if God was faithful this little bit, He'd be faithful throughout the whole thing. So now we need to really believe and trust Him that He is able to do the fishing of what He said He's going to do. The direction He's given us this morning, the new change in our life, He has shown us. Let's now really believe. But You know, the next thing happens, it will happen as well. And I'm not going to read through the whole thing by big little bits and pieces. Let's see here. And after Moses went in Aramean and told Pharaoh, "Thus the Lord God of Israel, let my people go, for they know how to feed some of me in the wilderness." And Pharaoh said, "Who is the Lord that I should obey his voice, let Israel go? I know not the Lord, neither will I let Israel go." And they said, "The God of the Hebrews hath met with us. Let us go and pray, we pray thee, 3 days' journey into the desert, and sacrifice unto the Lord our God, lest he fall upon us with pestilence or the sword." And the king of Egypt said to them, "Wherefore do ye, Moses and Aaron, let the people from their works? Go ye into the burdens. And Pharaoh said, "The people of the land now are many, and ye make them rest from their burdens." And Pharaoh commanded, same day, the taskmasters of the people and officers, saying, "Ye shall no more give the people straw made fig, as hitherto. Let them go and gather straw themselves." And then you step here, it says here, "Then officers of in 15, the officers of Israel came and cried to Pharaoh, saying, 'Wherefore didst thou thus with thy servants? There is no straw given to us thy servants, that they should send us. Make free, and behold, thy servants are beaten, for the fault is in thy own people.' But he said, 'Ye are idle. Therefore ye say, let us go and do sacrifice to the Lord. Go therefore now in the Lord, for there shall no straw be given to you. Yet shall ye deliver 10 bricks.' And officers of children of Israel did see that they were in evil case, after it was said, 'Ye shall not finish off from your bricks of your daily task.' And they met Moses and Aaron, who stood in the way, as they came with the Pharaoh. And they said to them, 'The Lord look upon you and judge, because you have made us more our savor to be abhorred in the eyes of Pharaoh, in the eyes of his servants, to put a sword in their hand and slay us.'" And this is something I want to drive home and drive in the hearts of the Lord. There will be a roadblock. When God has given you a new path, new direction, there will be a problem. You can guarantee it. There will be an issue that will pop up, and you think all good, and everything's going good, you're happy, and things get better. Roadblock. This is when the faith you have will be the test. This will define you in your path. And here's where you need to look back at what God has done for your life and has helped you and prospered you and strengthened you and that little faith, that confirmation He's given you, and realize that this one block, that's all it is. It's just slowing down. I'm still good with it because it's the path God has set for me. And we have all done that part in our lives in times past. But this path you're walking this morning, a roadblock is coming. There will be a problem will come up and arise and try your faith. And you'll say, is this a direction? Because he says here, and Moses returned to the Lord and said, "Lord, wherefore hast thou so evil entreated against this people? Why is it that thou hast sent me? For he said, I came to Pharaoh, speak in thy name, yet that evil this people, neither hast thou delivered thy people at all." So immediately Moses' faith was tested. Because now he had done what God said, and the roadblock had hit. The problems have failed in. You know, there's always going to be an issue. There's always going to be that problem. That car may stop. That car may blow. Your action may quit in the summertime. Or, you know, that gas bill, that power may high you thought. Or, that form may be replaced in the law. It may be something big. You think, how in the world? Why, God? Why? You know this path? And now, I can't see past this issue. I can't do it. But God has provided the way. If God has set you on a path, hold on and walk that path. But strengthen your hearts now while you're in that, while you're walking in peace. And heart thinking, the time's coming when I'm going to fight the roadblock. Satan will throw something in your way. It may be from a co-worker, it may be from family, it may be from a boss man, it may be from goodness. Who knows what may come up? But if you're in the path and God has set you directly, you know for a fact that that I am in the will of God and God's changed my life for this reason, I don't know what it is, see yourself that way and realize that God will get you to the no ball. No matter how hard it may be, no matter how much trouble it may be. And you know what? Perhaps Exodus, once those have to go down, there's more of a box, yes, but at this point here, God ruled by the power of Moses. Did Moses go up to Midian and become a shepherd again? No. He prayed to God and God answered him. And God strengthened him. And then was the mighty things done in Moses' life. Through Moses, the children of Israel kept set captive. They were kept set free. So that roadblock comes. Assure yourself before your heart before God that if God is sitting in your way, this new direction you're going in now, and it's time of change, He will see you through. But you can't come back. Don't turn back. Don't even in your mind, but you're thinking, I need to do something different. I need to come back. I need to change my way. If God is sitting in your way, walk it and see what leads. I got a few things here. Five things. I call them things for the journey. This is something as we walk in the direction we need to do in our hearts. We need to have. We need to get some of. If you haven't gotten yet, you know, a hiker who goes hiking in the woods, who is an experienced hiker, will have his rock tools with him. Potter, you need potting for. You need a tool you need. You know, a compass, water bottle, a camp axe. When you set on a hike trip, set on a journey, you will need to have in your path. And these are five things I would say you need to have for your journey as you're setting your path. The first thing, direction. Know that God has to stay in this path by knowing that we have tried to be in His will with our whole heart. We need to set that, before we start walking any direction once, but we need to set in our hearts that we are in the will of God. And once we're in the will of God, if we know we're doing the best of being in the will of God, we cannot be wrong. Because God will direct our paths. If we are in the will of God. Now, if you're not in the will of God, you may not watch which path you're taking. But if you are in the will of God, and you know you're in the will of God, and you know you've tried and sought the will of God, accept the new path of joy. Yeah, it's going to be a different change. It's going to be a little awkward for a while. It's going to be something new. It's going to be exciting. It's going to be a little scary. It's going to be a little softer. Maybe there's a lot of it most that you can feel when your path changes. But if you're in the will of God, that's your path. Because the second thing, faith. God has what's best for you. This is so hard to get that point. I guess picture things, all changes are good. In our eyes, it may be a massive change that completely brings us to our knees. We don't know what's going on, God. But if we have faith that God has set apart a new thing for us, it's going to work out for our good. If we have anchored that faith inside us, we can get through any kind of challenges He's got before us. Or any kind of new paths, or any kind of new ways, any kind of roadblocks. We're going to have faith that He has our best heart in our best interest. And that best for us may be not necessarily happiness, in the sense of the word, like most people get, I got plenty of stuff, I'm happy. But may true happiness, in the sense of moving mountains, but you don't see. We're going to have faith that God has best for us. Third was trust. And He will provide grace for the doubt that will come and the worry that will be calmed. We must get ready for us once again for the roadblocks, and that will bring doubt and that will bring worry. It's coming. Our human bodies are so fallen, so fragile. We will doubt, we will fear, we will get worried. But we need to trust that God, when those worries come, that issue comes, that God will provide us grace to give us peace those times. And to reach through, to walk those times, and to put our head down, and to really just push our mind together those things, because God will provide that grace for when that time comes. But we right now, at the start of a journey, that is going to be a tool in our pack. That trust already built up, that you know, when time gets hard, I know that God's going to give me one measure of grace. The fourth thing, patience, to do the questions that will arise. And patience is a hard thing to come up with, but when things change, we We must have patience. When that child is 2 weeks old and falls asleep in that class in that quite long, we must have patience. You know, as well as that, sad he's going to wake up at 12 o'clock that while he was there. We must have patience when that time comes that God knows what he's doing. And patience to endure long enough to have this question answered. And the fifth thing is resolve. Traveling the problems to get to what God's planned for you. This is a hard one to have because it's so easy to want to turn around and run back. But at this point here, if started journey, you need to put in your new pack. I'm going to have resolve to see this through. God has changed my life for some reason. I don't know what it is, big or small. But I will have the resolve to walk that path and not turn around and come back and run. Not turn around and back up, not wonder why God sent this way, but I have the resolve to do this because I know for a fact God has provided something great for me in the future. God has provided opportunity to me that I cannot see. These five things you need in your pack right now as your journey starts. As you see your path and you know that door opens and you walk that door, you need to have these with you and realize that this is a new thing for me. I'm on my comfort zone. I don't know where I'm going. I don't know what I'm doing exactly. But I will have these things and trust in God. I will have resolve. I will have trust. I will have faith. When you have those things and you really get into that journey, that path, and it starts winding and getting dark, or maybe smooth points in there and hit a bump. But once again, if we really trust God in this path, and we are really in our mind, our hearts, serving Him, we just gotta wait. Wait until the reasoning comes. And that reasoning comes, and that whole thing is lit up, and you realize why God sent that path, it's lit up. I never saw that. I would never have realized that. I will never have dreamed of the things He has now done wrong. So, the new path you have this morning, how are you going to take it? Are you going to do like the world does? And well, it's a 50-50 chance. It may turn good, it may turn bad. That's gambling. We can gamble on our choices. We can gamble on our ways. But if you're really loving God and doing His purposes and doing His will, there's no such thing as gambling. There's no such thing as risk. Everybody says, you have to take risk to get ahead. If you really love God, you take a risk. You go for a sure thing that God has prepared for you. And a sure thing that He will see you through to the end and provide something wonderful in the end. And that's what I'm going to close this morning. I said, we have all in this room, we all facing something new. And something big. Each one of us this morning is setting our life-changing thing right now. Something we have not done before. Are we trusting God that He will lead us through that thing and get us out and give us that glory that path will make? Because we need to. We start looking real far out and say, I'm looking past these problems. I'm looking past these roadblocks. I'm keep smiling my face. I'll enjoy the time that God's teaching me something. And I'll get that point and say, I understand. So as you think about this new way you're going on, and you're wondering in your mind, how am I going to make it? How am I going to do this? I can't, in this little part here, it's easy to get to the point of messing your mind up because you're worrying about, because what if this happens? I can't do this, but what just happens? But this may happen, this may happen, this may happen. We can find reason to worry. A person who's completely secure in every sense of the word can find reason to worry. That's where trust comes in. That's where we get from the world. If we have trust in God and of His blessings and His promises and His faithfulness, we can do it. Because we shouldn't have to worry. We shouldn't have to wonder about what makes sense because we know He's got our best at heart. And you may just be a lowly shepherd, and maybe about to lose the mountains. You need that to go into Egypt in the way that's hostile out and change a nation. You don't know. But God has now chosen you to come out of your comfort zone. The time has come. And now, there can't be turning back. It needs to be all ahead and trusting Him that He will see us through and will give us that grace, that strength to reach His purposes. So as we pray this morning, really, really resolve yourself to walk that path. No matter how many difficult it may be, no matter how many roadblocks, how many problems, but you will see the result that God has.
Heavenly Father, we ask that you just touch your heart with word, Lord, as we all face something new in our hearts, Lord, in our lives. As we face the unexpected, Lord, we don't even know what's coming. We know what's ahead for our lives and what you got in store for us, Lord. But we know by your word, your faithfulness, that it's going to be a good thing for us to do. It'll be a learning experience for us, no matter what may call, the problems it may bring, and the joys that may come past. But we know we have trust in you this morning. You have promised you will see us through, Lord, and you'll give us all our bones, our heart, Lord, according to your will. And we're just taking this blessing. Just bless each one of us who's facing that new choice in their life, Lord. That new direction that you're just taking this be with them, this guide them. It helps always to endure through it all until we see your eventual plan and purpose in our lives. And we ask in Jesus' name.